Yes, sir, we are live.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the webinar today from Dr. Reddy's. And on behalf of Dr. Reddy's, I'd like to thank everyone who have come here to attend this webinar. And I have an important topic and a very distinguished speaker for the topic today. And I'd like to introduce Dr. Sanjeev Singh Rawat sir, who is a senior pediatrician and who is the director of Child Care Hospital in Indore, and is also an honorary consultant at Apollo Hospital Indore, Greater Kailash Hospital at Indore. Dr. Rawat has held several positions in central IAP and also the state IAP, the central IAP executive member from Madhya Pradesh. And he has also served as a president for IAP Indore in the past. Dr. Rawat is presented many papers in several national and international conferences on infectious diseases, nutrition, vaccinology, and respiratory diseases. Today, he's going to deliberate on a topic which is antibiotic-associated dysbiosis in children, causes, consequences, and control. I'd like to invite Dr. Rawat sir to take over the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna. A warm welcome to all the panelists who are there on this platform. A warm welcome to all the delegates who have logged in for this webinar. Thanks to Dr. Krishna for being on this panel. Thanks to Dr. Reddy for having arranged this important webinar. I'll share my screen. So, dear friends, the topic for today's talk is antibiotic associated dysbiosis, cause, consequences, and control. You must be wondering that in the past we have associated antibiotic dysbiosis with antibiotic induced diarrhea, but I want to make it clear that antibiotic induced diarrhea is a very short segment of dysbiosic symptoms because of antibiotic. There are not many symptoms, there are not many problems are there, and the literature is absolutely full of lot of articles and lot of materials. So we like to go through this particular issue of antibiotic induced dysbiosis, and we like to see it in more detail. So any of you remember fire hose from a fire brigade? The speed with which water comes from that fire hose. So I don't think anybody can drink water from that hose, because it is coming from such a huge speed that you are immediately going to get washed off. When I was trying to prepare for this particular program, when I logged in Google and I wanted to search on PubMed for dysbiosis and probiotics, all those things, there were almost 20,000 papers if they came. So there was a huge information. And getting information from internet is just like drinking from a fire hose, because so much information is there. And some are fake, some are genuine. So what I have done is that I have taken some very genuine article from very genuine journals, and I will try to present this information in a very simple manner so that you can understand the concept of dysbiosis as well as the problem arises from dysbiosis. So the basic plan would be, we'll discuss human microbiome and what do we mean by dysbiosis. We'll discuss about antibiotic use and how it causes dysbiosis. And in the last, we'll discuss Saccharomyces boulardii, what it can do to treat and prevent dysbiosis. So first we'll discuss what is human microbiome. Human microbiome, it comprises of trillions of microbes which inhabit mucosal surface of human body and play an important role in various multiple physiological and pathological processes that affect the host health throughout the life cycle. So all mucosal surfaces like oral cavity, genital urinary, gastrointestinal, skin, they all are inhabited by friendly bacteria, and these all they contribute human microbiome, and they are our fellow travelers for the entire journey of life. Most of them, they are friendly, they would be giving some beneficial effect, and really they can cause problem, particularly when there is some disbalance. So basically we will be concentrating ourselves only on microbiome present in the GI tract, because that is the biggest place where huge amount of microbiome load is there. So we will be concentrating our discussion on GI microflora. And in this microbiome, particularly in GI tract, you can have bacteria, you can have fungi, you can have viruses. So all these three, they are a part of human microbiome. They coexist with the human being, and they exist throughout the life, and they affect our health. Now, this concept of human and human microbiota, this combination is termed as a supraorganism. What do you mean by supraorganism? Whenever two species, they coexist along with each other, and they function more efficiently, this particular combination is known as supraorganism. That means that it is beneficial to either, something like symbiosis. So initially it was for same species, but now currently even different species, they can also coexist in beneficial to each other, and that is concept known as supraorganism. So amount of microbes which we are harboring in our body, we may be more of a bug rather than a human being. And I'll just explain this particular concept to you. So human along with microorganisms, these two, they form a concept known as supraorganism, because these two, when they act in unison, they act to the benefit of each other more effectively. So if it's a human being, it contains 10 trillion cells and about 23,000 genes. Whereas if you see the microorganisms in our body, particularly GI microflora, there are 100 trillion cells, almost 10 times more cells that we have, and mind-boggling 3 million genes. So human is only 10 trillion cells and 23,000 genes. Microorganisms, they contain 100 trillion cells and 3 million genes. And these two, they exist in unison. Human being, by providing nutrition and immunity, it affects the microflora or microbiota. And the microbes, by producing some toxins and beneficial metabolites, they affect the human being. So both of them, they exist in a symbiotic manner, which are beneficial to each other. And this concept is known as a supraorganism. And of course, environment plays an important part, both in the functioning of human being as well as microorganism. So when these two things are functioning in unison, so you have got a thing known as eubiosis, where the status is healthy. And whenever this balance, it gets disturbed, that means that whenever this microflora gets disturbed, this balance gets tilted, and you can go on for about the disease. So this concept of supraorganism, this is a relatively new concept which came in about 2014. And this indicates that if both are functioning in unison with a beneficial effect to each other, you will get a status of health. And if both are working not in tandem, you get disease. So microbiota, it was a forgotten organ. Like about 20 years back, nobody used to think much about microbiota. But now, from a forgotten organ, it has become a potential key player, because a lot of reports are coming, a lot of articles are coming, and a lot of role of microbiota in health and disease is now getting unraveled. So to just cut short, these microbes colonize GI tract. They influence the local systemic processes like nutrient transformation. Again, they have a very important role in producing vitamins, particularly B-complex and B12, which is made from intestinal microbiota. They give vitamins supply, maturation of immunity. Again, this immunity business is very important, because human microbiota, they played an extremely important role in maturation of gut immune system, secretion of IgA, and it plays a very important part in prevention of GI infection. then there is known as gut to brain axis, in which products from microbiota, some peptides, they are released, which act on the brain. Brain releases hormones which act on the microbiota, and they both exist in unison. This is known as gut brain axis. And even if there is tumor, it also sometimes can enhance tumor proliferation. So microbiota has got some very important vital function which are important for human existence. So you can view this microbiota as an actual body organ, because it is like you take off your head, your brain, eyes, nose, your stomach, ileum. Similarly, entire microbiota can be considered as a body organ which has got some very important function to play, and if it is not taken care of properly, it can lead to havoc. So we are not absolutely bad, and we are absolutely important, and we are beneficial. So now this concept of dysbiosis, like other organs, the proper functioning of gut microbiota relies on a stable cellular composition, which in case of human being, it consists of bacteria from phyla, bacteroidetes, firmicutes, actinobacteria, and very rarely proteobacteria. So these are all the major phyla of bacteria which are present in the human microbiota, like bacteroids, firmicutes, actinobacteria, and very small amount of proteobacteria. So when all these phyla, they exist in a unison, in a proper proportion, then it leads to a condition known as eubiosis. And whenever this ratio is disturbed, whenever there is a large shift in ratio between these phyla, or sometimes a new bacterial group starts getting prominent. So for example, enterobacteriaceae, when it gets more prominent, you get condition known as diarrhea. So whenever the ratio of these, for example, you get more amount of bacteroids and less amount of formicutes. If this ratio is reversed, if you get more formicutes, you get more intestinal problem, allergies, and it leads to dysbiosis. So whenever the ratio between these important phyla is disturbed, or whenever a new bacterial clone starts proliferating, it is known as dysbiosis. And a large number of diseases, as a thought processor, you will come to realize that huge number of diseases, to name a few, like NEC, inflammatory bowel disease, Clostridium difficile, diarrhea, and asthma, they can you hear me?
Sir, we lost your slides in between just now.
Oh, okay, I'll again log in. Can you see my slides?
Not yet, sir.
Can you see my slides?
It's showing. Yes, sir. Now I can see. Yes.
Okay.
I can see dysbiosis slides.
Okay. So, as I told you, sorry for the interruption. So, dysbiosis, whenever, like other organs, the proper functioning of gut microbiota relies on a stable cellular composition, which in case of human microbiota consists of bacteria from phyla, bacteroids, firmicutes, actinobacteria, and proteobacteria. And whenever there is a large shift in ratio between these two phyla, or expansion of any new bacterial group which can be producing a disease, it is known as dysbiosis. And a lot number of diseases, they are linked to dysbiosis, like NEC, IB, inflammatory bowel disease, Clostridium difficile, diarrhea, and asthma. And we will be discussing about more diseases at the top of process. So dysbiosis and its consequences. Now dysbiosis can have huge consequences, and with this particular diagram we'll understand. So if you see the
Hello, we are facing some internet issue at sir's side. Sir, can you hear us? Yes, sir. The video also has lag in it. So,
can you see my slide?
No, sir.
Can you see it now? Dr. Krishna?
Yes. Not yet, sir.
Huh?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet?
No, not yet, sir. I cannot see it now. You have started screen sharing. The screen is plain for now.
Is it visible?
It's loading, I think. It has started screen sharing, it has come. I think the slides are loading.
Is it visible now?
It is visible now, yes.
Okay. So now we will see the consequences of these biases and what it can occur. So if you see our normal microbiome, this normal microbiome, if you see the part of GIT, this is a present in the entire GI tract, and I am going to magnify this part of colon where I am going to tell you the details. This is the colonic mucosa, and it has got a thick layer of mucin. This is the inner layer of mucin, which contains this all particles are antibodies, and outer layer it contains all these bacteria which form the microbiota. So they have got an important metabolic capacity. They can produce very important molecules, for example, vitamins. They have got very important effect on immune system maturation because there is all mucosal, below some mucosal, there is a lot of gut-associated lymphoid tissue. And these bacteria, they play a very important role in the maturation of this particular tissue. And then they also have a very important action of small chain fatty acid production. And this all, again, has got a very important metabolic role. So this all entire normal microbiome is going to have these three important functions. Now, if it is a germ-free, like a newborn, a mice which has been just been born or it has been made germ-free in lab. So what you see in this condition, you have got an altered intestinal mucosa and altered immunity. And the gut lymphoid tissue, it is poor developed, metabolic capacity is poor. So this germ-free mice without any microbiome, it is going to have all these problems, and only when this mice get exposed to the environment, start taking some food, then again the intestine they get colonized, and again you get a normal microbiome. Obesity, what will happen if a person consumes a lot of high fat and lot of fat that contain example carbohydrates and fat? So what will happen? There is increased production of short chain fatty acids, there is abnormal polysaccharide degradation genes. And formicutes, they become more. Whereas microbial diversity goes down and bacteroids, they go down. So whenever there is a change in this ratio, there is more amount of formicutes and more SCA production. In case of this biases, what happened that whenever
Sir, we lost you. We lost the slides again, sir. I think the internet connection may be slow on your side. Even the video is showing lag.
Okay. I think...
Sir, it's internet connection problem. It's better you join again.
Can you rejoin, sir? Yes, sir. I think... Yes, sir. Gayatri, is that the way to do?
What, sir?
Should sir log out and log in back?
Yeah. Sure. Sir, please rejoin again. That will be helpful, I think.
Visible now?
Yeah, it's visible, sir.
Yeah, it's back to visible, yes.
So, we were on this basis. So, whenever there are, whenever, more importantly, whenever the gut is exposed to antibiotic, or inflammatory bowel disease, or whenever there is bacterial infection, there is a condition of this patient wherever you get inflammation and enterobacterial disease, they get more prominent and the microbial diversity goes down, the obligate anaerobes they go down and decrease in production of short-term fatty acid. This condition is known as a disease basis, and again it can be treated by probiotics or by fast therapy or by fecal transplant. Again, you can convert this this condition to eubiosis. Virome, again, there are a lot of viruses in the gut, and these, they form an important commensal part known as virome. Again, they are basically they are macrophages, and they also can control this particular microbial colonization to a great extent by genetic control, because these are macrophages which can transmit the genetic information to the bacteria, and again they can promote the growth of friendly bacteria. And finally, the host, where you see whenever you got a healthy microbiome, this microbiome is going to secrete lot of substances like peptides and hormones which are going to affect the brain, and brain will also secrete various factors like neurotransmitters which will affect the microbiota. So this entire thing is known as a gut brain axis. And a healthy gut-brain axis is important for neurodevelopment development, because if this axis gets disturbed, you can get conditions like ADHD and even autism. Because there are studies which have told that all these conditions like autism and ADHD, they can have an underlying disturbed microflora. This gut-brain axis is also very important. So as you see, normal microbiome to function is extremely important, and when it gets disturbed, conditions like obesity and all these things they can arise. So, although you might be thinking that this concept of microbiota and microbiome and dysbiosis is new, but no. In the last century, in the late 19th century, even the scientists, they were much aware of the importance of this particular our body organ and what role is going to play. As you see, this scientist, Eli Metchnikoff, in the late 19th century, he also mentioned that in the digestive tract can only be solved by long-term research on intestinal flora of human and animal in the normal and pathological state. So he created light in the late 19th century that problems of GI tract, they can be handled very well if you take care of the intestinal flora. Then again, Dr. Eliot Fernie, again in the late 19th century, in this book known as a culture, a modern method, he told that eubiosis may make your living made easy and dysbiosis will make a difficult living. So they had emphasized that probably for a healthy living, you require a eubiosis, and for disease state, probably dysbiosis is going to cause. In the late part of 19th century and in earlier 20th century, again, Dr. Arthur Schoenert, he told that, I believe that extensive knowledge is to be expected here, and that dysbiosis of the digital flora, as I recall, may play a decisive role. So I think this concept, even scientists, quite some time back in the late 19th century, they were aware of the importance of this particular intestinal microflora and the role it's going to play in both health as well as disease. So now we'll see what are the factors which shape microbiome, because the first 1,000 days, first 3 years are extremely important to shape the microbiome, because by the end of 3 years, you get an adult microflora. So whatever changes are going to occur in the first 3 years, they're going to carry on for the later life. So the first 3 years are extremely important to make your normal microflora. So the first, if you see in utero, we had a concept that in utero, the entire in utero environment is sterile. No, it is not that. Recent studies have shown that placenta is harboring commensal microflora. The meconium, in a child who is just born, again meconium contains microflora. So there is some normal microflora even in the placenta and even in the newborn gut, which can have an important bearing on the newborn development. This intrauterine microflora can be changed from the gut microbiota of a mother. It can be changed from the bilateral infection and oral microflora through peritonitis. So whenever mother is having any illness related to her GI tract, vagina, or in oral cavity, you can get a change in the microflora in utero, and it can affect the growth of the newborn baby. When the newborn baby is born, he can be delivered by vaginal delivery. When through vaginal delivery, mainly he gets colonized by lactobacillus. Whereas if it is a cesarean delivery, because he is handled by a lot of people, so you get higher amount of staph as well as probiobacterium. So it depends upon the birth of the child. If he delivers vaginally, you get a lot of friendly lactobacillus. Wherever it is through LSTS, the microflora is again not to the benefit of the newborn baby. So again, we have to be extremely particular whenever the baby is born through LSTS. Then as the child grows in the below 1 year, if he takes mainly breastfeeding, he takes only mother's milk, you get a lot of growth of bifidobacterium, lactobacillus and legionella. Whereas as soon as the baby shifts from milk feeding to cow feeding, you get higher amount of bacteroides and clostridia. So again, it depends upon the food that the child is taking. So in the infancy, when the child is taking antibiotics, his microbiota gets depleted, you get dysbiosis. If you take good amount of breastfeeding, his entire gut is colonized by bifidobacterium and lactobacillus, which is a friendly bacteria. So that's why we stress half and a half more and more on taking breastfeeding. Fourth, another factor, it also has a very important role on which particular bacteria is going to colonize. Again, environmental factors, they are important, because if you see different part of the world, you get different microflora in the gut. So environmental factors, they also play a extremely important part. So from toddler to 1 to 3 years, as a person takes normal diet, as he takes full diet, the gut is get colonized by adult like microflora. So that by the end of 3 years, the entire gut microflora it gets mature, and you get an adult type of microbiota. So as you see, the 1000 days are extremely important, and out of that, if a mother maintains a good health, if she's having a healthy gut microbiota, if she doesn't have any germinal infection, if she's having a good oral hygiene, the intrauterine flora would be good. If you beat the baby on breastfeeding, child take good amount of breastfeeding for the first 6 months with very few antibiotic exposure, again, you'll have a very healthy microbiota. After 6 months, if you introduce again solid food, again, if the baby is in a good environment, microbiota will be healthy. So by the end of 3 years, you'll have a nice, healthy microbiota which can ensure a good normal growth. So after seeing this normal microbiota and the formation of this normal microflora, we'll see what antibiotic use can do to this particular microflora. Now, as you are all aware, 1924 was the time when penicillin was first discovered, and it led to absolutely change in the scene, in which the infection which usually used to cause death, very minor infection like pharyngitis, skin infection, they used to become very serious and the person used to die. As penicillin was discovered in 1924, after that the scene changed, and the infection they got controlled in a much more easy manner. Hence, antibiotics, they started getting prescribed more and more. And as you see, the current data says that antibiotics are one of the most commonly prescribed medication to infants and children in the Western world. Things are same in India also. So almost 10% of the children in Europe, they are given antibiotics. So 100 children coming to the hospital in Europe, almost 10 children will get antibiotic. Whereas in USA, the current data says that almost 25% of children, they get antibiotic. So if you see, it is one of the most commonly prescribed drug to children. Now, we are much aware of the problem of antibiotic overuse causing increased amount of antibiotic resistance. So this thing is a menace. Everybody is thinking about it, everybody is talking, and we are taking all the steps to take care of this menace. But a very important effect which we are not too much aware is antibiotic induced alteration of microflora known as dysbiosis, which is going to cause a more chronic problems in the children, which we are not seeing at present because it is not visible immediately. But now there are a lot of papers that are indicating that if you don't stop using antibiotic indiscriminately, definitely you are going to increase the load of the diseases, which are all chronic diseases, and they will cause much more havoc as compared to your antibiotic induced drug resistance. So antibiotic can dramatically alter both adult as well as infant microbiome. And the condition, even in India, it is not absolutely healthy. This is a study which was published in 2017, in which they did a point prevalence survey of antimicrobial use among children's hospital in India. And if you see, almost 18.4% children were prescribed ceftriaxone, and you see amoxicillin, carbamic acid, cefotaxime, amikacin, metronidazole. So all these antibiotics, they are used quite frequently in children in India, and we are not much behind even in the Western world. So we will not discuss whether they are used discriminately or indiscriminately. But yes, one factor is definitely sure that antimicrobial use in India also, it is to get extent. Now, what an antibiotic have to do? Antibiotic, whenever they are given to any person, the basic effect they are going to do is that they decrease the diversity of the microbiome. As you see, the normal microbiome is very diverse. It contains bacteria from different phyla. As compared to when you give antibiotic, the diversity goes down, so that very few phyla are remaining, and a lot of friendly bacteria, they are all wiped out. So the antibiotic diversity of the microbiome, it goes down. So what it happens? Because friendly bacteria are gone, that's why there are niches which are formed where pathogenic bacteria can stay and they can grow. They would disturb the epithelial barrier. They would cause liver antigen to get exposed to immune cell. There is also alteration in the gene expression, and this all will lead to local inflammation, systemic inflammation, and at the end, what you will get? Chronic diseases like allergic, autoimmune, infectious, inflammatory, metabolic, and neoplastic. So a very innocuous event like giving an antibiotic to a child for a short period, it is going to cause such a long-standing problem. So gut dysbiosis triggered by antibiotic can lead to a complex downstream effect on gut barrier function, gene expression, and epigenetic markers. So it is going to cause a permanent change in the genetic structure, and it will give important niches for pathogenic bacteria to grow, and ultimately it will alter the immune response, local as well as systemic, and it will lead to chronic diseases. So antibiotic can really play havoc. Important thing is that it is not evident very soon, very early, but long-term effects are there, and now there are a lot of papers which are coming, which are indicating this long-term effect. So antibiotic consequences can be short-term, in which you can get in weeks or days, they can get antibiotic-associated diarrhea. And normally we see this more commonly. So we give antibiotic to a child, he gets diarrhea, you stop the antibiotic, you do some probiotic, he gets all right. So these are short term consequences. Whereas if you see immediate term consequences, it can occur from weeks to months, where you can get overgrowth of Clostridium difficile. It can lead to relapsing diarrhea. It can lead to irritable bowel syndrome. It can lead to dyspepsia. So these symptoms, they last for weeks to months, in which you can get these all symptoms. Whereas long-term consequences, they can occur over months to years, where you can get obesity and diabetes, inflammatory bowel disease and autoimmune disease like diabetes mellitus, anxiety, depression, intellectual disorders like autism and ADHD. So you have got short-term consequences which are easily evident, medium consequences which are seen but not less commonly, and long-term consequences which are never seen, never thought, but they are exist, they are there. And now a lot of association is being proved regarding diabetes and obesity with disturbed microflora. So this is a big table indicating a lot of studies which they indicate the long-term effect. I just highlighted for you, increased risk of obesity. This was a paper which came in 2015, and antibiotic exposure was in prenatal period. The mother received antibiotic, and the age at 7 years, they found that the higher risk of childhood obesity, risk of asthma and food allergies. Paper came in 2015, 2013, 14 and 17. And again, the antibiotic was given in prenatal period to the mother and in early life in the first 6 months. Child was evaluated at 3 years, 5 years and 7 years, and risk of asthma and food allergies was thought. Again, indicating that if you give antibiotic even to the mother or in early life, it is going to cause long-term problems like obesity and asthma. Increased risk of IBD, like this again, paper came in 2011, where antibiotic given in early life in the first 2 years of life, and the age at studied was at 9 years, and what they found that there is increased risk of inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. So these important problems like asthma, food allergies, and obesity, they can be clearly linked to antibiotic exposure by these studies. Then again, the risk of childhood obesity paper came in 2014. The antibiotic was given in first 12 months of life and evaluated at 12 years, where they indicated the risk of obesity. So now there are a lot of papers, they are even covering more and more, which indicate that if you give an antibiotic at very early age, either to the mother or in the first year of life, things like asthma, inflammatory bowel disease, obesity, diabetes, they are going to come. Although papers are telling correlation, although there is no still very firm evidence for that. But I think as more and more papers come, more and more research is conducted, definitely we will have more and more positive correlation between and antibiotic and these diseases. So this is one of the most important papers that I am going to discuss. This paper has come from Mayo Clinic, in which they have tried to discuss the association of antibiotic exposure with childhood outcome. This study was done in US in Minnesota, Olmsted County, where they have got a very excellent epidemiological record, where they keep record of all children who are born in that particular county, and then they follow this children for their health and disease, and they maintain a record in a very excellent manner. So this study was done, in which they studied the antibiotic prescription in children in the first two years of life, and this was studied from 2003 to 2011, where in the first 2 years they studied which children they had received an antibiotic, and then for the next about 11 years to 2 to 13 years, they studied the effect of what effect on the health it occurred. So this antibiotic prescription was studied from 2003 to 2011. And the health was studied till 2016. Since they had maintained a very excellent record, so they had got a very clear indication which children is an antibiotic and what was the outcome. Total patient assessed were 18,000 patients were assessed for eligibility. Out of them, 14,000 children were followed. It is a very huge study with a very robust study design. So we'll see what is the association of antibiotic prescription and risk of health and condition. So I've tried to highlight, if you see asthma, children who have received 1 to 2 course of antibiotic, 3 to 4 and more than 5. If you see the hazard risk, as the number of prescription they rise, hazard risk increases from 1.5 to 3. And if you see, it is highly significant statistically, both females as well as males. So children who receive an antibiotic in their early year, from first years of life, as the number of prescription they get more and more, risk of asthma, it gets increasing, and it is significant statistically. And you see the confidence interval, it is so tight, 2.3 to 3.9, 1.2 to 2.2. This tight interval indicates that these results are highly significant. If you see for allergic rhinitis, same. Antibiotic prescription from 1 to 2 to more than 5. Hazard risk is 2.12. And again, it is highly significant with very tight confidence interval. If you see for atopic dermatitis, again, 3 to 4 prescription, hazard risk is 1.8. Again, it is significant statistically. Celiac disease, again, a disease-related disease. Again, it is an autoimmune disease. And higher the prescription, higher the hazard risk. Although the confidence interval are very wide in this thing, but still the result they indicate that if you are using antibiotic in your early life, risk of celiac disease is also there. Then other things like overweight. Again, if you see more than 5 prescription, hazard risk is 1.45, significant statistically, very tight confidence interval. Obesity, more than 5 prescription, hazard risk is 1.37, significant statistically, tight confidence interval. Very important, ADHD, more than 5 prescriptions, hazard risk is 1.78, it is significant statistically, p-value, and tight confidence interval. So again, it indicates that whenever the child is using, getting antibiotic in the initial years of life, this paper has said very clearly that these all diseases are going to increase, and more the number of prescriptions you are going to get antibiotic, the more risk it is there. And since, as you see, the all the data, they are indicating of a very important statistical significance, and a low and a tight confidence interval indicate that this data is very significant. So receiving 3 to 4 prescriptions of antibiotic associated with high incidence of asthma, atopic dermatitis, and overweight in both sexes, and ADHD and celiac disease was seen in girls, and obesity was seen in boys. And both girls and boys who received more than 5 prescriptions or more had a significantly higher risk of asthma, allergic rhinitis, overweight, obesity, and ADHD, and girls were risk for celiac disease. So this indicates that the more number of prescriptions you are getting, the more you will get disease, which are both autoimmune, allergic, as well as metabolic in nature. Along with that, there are some neuro diseases also, like, for example, ADHD, indicating that antibiotic prescription in the first year of life, it should be done in a very careful manner. So along with that, as you've seen, that antibiotic prescription is going to give you diseases. But if you get exposed to multiple antibiotics, you can get even more than one condition. This slide tells you about that. So this, there are 4 groups: group with no antibiotics, group receiving 1 to 2 antibiotics, 3 to 4 antibiotics, more than 5 antibiotics. This blue zone, it indicates child is having one condition. This brown zone indicates child developed 2 conditions, and yellow zone indicates child developed 3 conditions. So as you see, the more number of antibiotics the child got, this yellow zone, it starts increasing in the size, indicating that child is having more than one condition. So if you get multiple antibiotics in your initial life, obesity seen along with asthma, learning disability, ADHD, and asthma is seen along with rhinitis. So even as along with that, you are getting your problem, you're getting more number of conditions occur along with each other. So more number of antibiotic, more number of condition, they can coexist along with that. And in the end, what is the risk of exposure as related to the time? As you see, for asthma, if you are giving antibiotic from 0 to 6 months, the risk ratio is 1.53, whereas from 12 to 24 months, 1.63. And PVP value again is again significant, less than 0.001 with tight confidence interval. Allergic rhinitis, again, 0 to 6 months, the risk is high and tight confidence interval, and this statistically is significant. Whereas if you see for overweight, 0 to 6 months, again, the risk is 1.25, significant statistically. For obesity, again, 0 to 6 months, significant statistically. What does it indicate? That antibiotic, if they are given before 6 months, it is going to cause a significant amount of atopic dermatitis, overweight, ADHD in both sexes, and asthma, allergy, rhinitis, and obesity in girls, and food allergy in boys. So I think this study has very clearly indicated that first 6 months is most important. So if you are careless in your first 6 months, you give antibiotic indiscriminately, even a single prescription is bad, but more number of prescriptions you are given to these children in first 6 months, the more risk of chronic diseases like asthma, allergy, obesity, and overweight are going to occur. And based on this paper indicating that the results are significant statistically with very tight confidence interval. So this study concluded that in present study of population-based cohort of children, antibiotic exposure in first 2 years of life was associated with an increased risk of immunological, metabolic, and neurobehavioral childhood onset of health conditions. And our findings are consistent with hypothesis that early life microbiome is a critical health determinant and that perturbation during key development periods can have a long-term effect. So I think this paper from Mayo Clinic is a very recent paper which came in 2020, hardly a few months back. And it has shown very clearly that early life microbiome is most important. So first 6 months, if you are giving a child breastfeeding, and if it remains free from antibiotic, you can ensure that all the chronic diseases are going not to occur. And in case if you are giving him top feeding, if you deprive him of breastfeeding, give antibiotic, all these problems are going to occur. So I think this paper has informed this particular thing very clearly. So after seeing the antibiotic microbiome and the long-term effect, now we'll see what we can do for it. And luckily, we are having a very good molecule, Saccharomyces boulardii. This is a yeast, and it can has a very important and even important role in treating and preventing this dysbiosis. And we'll see what is the evidence. Before we go through this thing, you must be very clear that this Saccharomyces boulardii, this particular strain, CNCM I745, because in market there are lot of generic forms are available which get very cheap. But I think whenever you are prescribing any Saccharomyces boulardii, you must be very clear that this particular strain, CNCM I745, it should be there, because this is the original strain which is going to have, because all the evidence they are being searched and they are being put with using this particular strain. So whenever you're using Saccharomyces boulardii, please confirm that you are using the correct strain. So how does this act? This particular probiotic, it creates a favorable and microbial environment, and both beneficial in case of dysbiosis as well as in preventive action. So what does it do? The first important action is that it prevents the mucinous layer. As you've seen that the intestinal lumen, it's got a thick layer of mucus. So this as boulardii is going to protect this mucus layer. It will eliminate the bacterial toxins and it prevents the pathogen binding. So in case of dysbiosis, it will protect against pathogen and the toxin. It will help in regeneration of mucosal cell. Whereas in preventive action also, it has got the same effect, protect against pathogen and their toxin. It also acts as an important substrate for these bacteria, because this particular yeast, it has a beneficial effect, act as a substrate for this, as a prebiotic for this microflora, and it also has an effect on stimulation of acid enzyme. What does it do in this dysbiosis? It can help in regeneration and subluxation of healthy microbiota. It can improve the enzymatic function of microbial cell. Whereas in preventive action, it can also stabilize the healthy microbiota and it improves enzymatic function of mucosal cell. Whereas it has got a very important action on general immune stimulation, has got an important anti-inflammatory effect and anti-secretory function. And it, in case of dysbiosis, helps in reduction of secretory water loss and electrolyte loss, decreases the inflammation, because it has got an important anti-inflammatory effect. And also in healthy, in preventive action, it stimulates the gut immune system, includes the secretion of IgA, and it prevents an infection. So as you see, as boulardii has got three important action. It protects your mucinous layer. It has got a very important prebiotic effect. It acts as a substrate for my microflora, and it has got a general immune stimulation as an antiseptic effect. So these are the action by which as boulardii acts, and it acts both during dysbiosis as well as it in during health and as well as in disease. So this particular graph, this particular paper, it came in 2015, in which they in lab they saw what are the effect of prebiotic on dysbiosis. So whenever prebiotic was given for example 2 weeks, the microflora at the level it was this at the level before antibiotic was given, this microflora went down, and it took a very long time to recover. So as soon as you give an antibiotic given for 2 weeks, the microflora, it sharply goes down and it takes long time to recover. They gave S. boulardii after the antibiotic was stopped, and the microflora, it recovered, but it took a longer time and the recovery was slow. Whereas if the S. boulardii was given during antibiotic only, again the recovery was good. This green, it took a longer time, but ultimately it recovered to the normal. Whereas This black indicates when SBRT was given during antibiotic and for at least for 2 weeks beyond. So there was a prompt recovery of microflora and it came back to normal. So what this study indicated that whenever you are giving an antibiotic to a child for at least 2 weeks, the microflora gets disturbed. And if you are giving SBRT during antibiotic therapy and 2 weeks later, the recovery of microflora is prompt and it comes to normal quite quickly. So indicating that whenever you are going to use SBRT to prevent this passage, you start with the giving that antibiotic and continue for at least 2 weeks after you have stopped the antibiotic therapy. So now we have got important two probiotic strains in market. One we have got bacteria LGG. Apart from that, others we also like Lactobacillus, Bifidobacterium, but they all are bacteria. And along with that, we have got SBRT, which is a yeast. So all these bacteria they are susceptible to antibiotic. You see this particular chart. All the bacteria like Lactobacillus and Bacillus, they can be killed by all these bacteria. If you see penicillin, amoxicillin, and methicillin and cephalosporin. So these all bacteria they are susceptible to this antibiotic, and they can be made inactive. Whereas if you see for SBRT, none of the antibiotics they can act on this particular strain of yeast. In indicating that this, if you use any bacterial probiotic, there are chances that if you use along with antibiotic, these bacteria can be destroyed by antibiotic and their action can be less. Whereas if you're using SBRT, because it is resistant to all antibiotic, so its effect will full and you can get an excellent effect. If you compare the difference between probiotic and yeast, probiotic, bacteria or yeast, in case of bacteria like Lactobacillus, in human microbiota, 99% of them they are bacteria, whereas only 1% is yeast. So, Lactobacillus bacillari is a temporary resident in GI tract, and after you stop the drug, it gets excreted after some time. Again, this antibiotic they are microbe-like, whereas yeast they are eukaryote-like, and they are very close to human cell. So they mimic the effect of human cell. Cell size for bacteria, they are 1 micrometer. Yeast, they are 10 micrometer. So yeast, they have got a large surface area as compared to bacteria. So they can protect the intestine wall much, much better as compared to bacteria when there is a pathogenic attack. So cell wall, bacteria contains peptidoglycan, lipopolysaccharide, and LTA. Whereas yeast, they contain chitin, mannose, and glucan. And pathogen, they can adhere to the surface of yeast, and they can get carried off in the fecal stream. And this particular cell wall in yeast, they have got a very strong immune suppressant effect, and they can act through toll-like receptors and lysine receptors, where they can have a good immune suppression. So yeast cell wall has got a very strong immune suppressant effect. They can grow, for bacteria, they can grow pH from 6.5 to 7.5. So in acidic pH, they can be destroyed, whereas yeast can grow 4.5 to 6.5. So they can survive in gastric acid and bile salt, and hence they can have their full action potential. Transmission of genetic material. Bacteria, because they can transmit the genetic material to other bacteria in the gut, whereas yeast they cannot transfer. So there is always a risk of transfer of resistant gene from probiotic in case if they are harming some gene resistant to the bacteria, whereas in yeast that thing is not possible. They are not resistant to antibiotics. For bacteria, they are not resistant to antibiotic. They can be destroyed, whereas yeast they are resistant to antibiotic. Immune stimulation, as I have told you, bacteria they cause limited immune stimulation, whereas yeast they have got a very important immune stimulation. So as you compare both bacterial probiotic as well as yeast, you find that yeast they score much, much more higher as compared to bacterial probiotic. So we see, so as I told you, out of all these indications, wherever we find the correlation between antibiotic use and long-term effect, we have got very strong indication, very strong evidence regarding the use of this probiotic in case of antibiotic-associated diarrhea. So if you see, there are very firm, important global recommendations from Hespagan 2020, they have indicated that SBRT is a drug of choice to prevent antibiotic-associated diarrhea. In Latin American guidelines in 2015, they again indicated the use of SBRT for AD. World Gastroenterology Organization, WGO, in 2017 guidelines, they have indicated that Enbrelanti is their drug of choice for preventing antibiotic-resistant diarrhea. In the specific guidelines, again, they have indicated in 2017. Nelsatetrachol pediatric, which is one of the Bible for pediatrician. In addition, it has clearly indicated that Enbrelanti is a drug of choice for preventing antibiotic-resistant diarrhea. And in European Pediatric Association, again, they have indicated that in 2018, that Enbrelanti is a drug of choice for AAD. So as you see, we have got six important recommendations for use of Enbrelanti for antibiotic-associated diarrhea. So whenever you're going to prevent AAD, always think of Enbrelanti. Nelson and his book in iteration clearly says that Enbrelanti is effective antibiotic-associated and C. difficile diarrhea, and there is some evidence that it can also prevent diarrhea in decathlon. Again, very important observation, and it is for us to follow it. Mixture of strain. As you see, in market, you see there are a lot of combination available, in which you take combination of the different probiotics. Again, Nelson has said very, very, very clearly that a specific strain can have beneficial effect when administered alone, whereas when included in a mixture, effect is eliminated, indicating that whenever using probiotic, always use a single strain, don't use a combination. So there are very, very rare evidence of use of combination of probiotic. Always use a single probiotic. Again, Nelson has told it very, very clearly. World Gastroenterology Guidelines into 2017, to prevention of antibiotic-associated diarrhea, you can use either LGG or Enbrelanti, and the dose is 250 to 500 milligram for Enbrelanti, and the evidence level is 1. So to summarize my talk, early life antibiotic and their impact on gut microbiota include following: loss of key microbial species, loss of microbial diversity, shift in metabolic capacity, and increasing concentration of pathogens. Antibiotic alter the microbial balance, commonly resulting in antibiotic-associated diarrhea. Probiotic may prevent AAD by providing gut barrier, restoration of gut microflora, and other potential mechanism of action. Antibiotic effect on microbiota composition, it persists for a period of weeks to months with significant differences in microbial composition even 2 years after. So indicating that once antibiotic is given, not necessarily that it is going to recover faster. If you don't take corrective steps, it is going to last for months to sometimes to years. And gut microbial dysbiosis is believed to be associated with etiology and development of childhood obesity, inflammatory bowel disease, risk of severe immunological, metabolic, and neurobehavioral childhood onset health condition. So there is very strong evidence indicating that if you have intestinal dysbiosis caused by antibiotic, these are things that will come in the long run. Yeast probiotic like Enbrelanti, CNCM, I745 are less likely to cause antibiotic resistance and can be safely used along with antibiotic, unlike bacterial probiotic like LGG. So because this yeast is resistant to antibiotic, it can be used along with antibiotic. And Enbrelanti is effective in antibiotic-associated diarrhea and C. difficile diarrhea. So my dear friends, evidence-based medicine, the global pharmaceutical industry is a 600 billion enterprise. It is rife with corruption and greed. There are flawed clinical trials followed by a suppression of unfavorable results, poor regulation, disease invented purely for profits and stolen marketing results. So my dear friends, whenever you are undergoing any review of any article, please see the fine print. Please go through the entire article very closely, because there are chances that the results can be inflated, the results can be flawed, the trial can be absolutely flawed. So out of this entire maze of evidence present in the internet, select out important studies, select out guidelines from important world bodies, and then take your decision. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I'd like to answer them.
Thank you, Dr. Rawat sir, for the comprehensive and lucid presentation on antibiotic associated dysbiosis, causes, consequences, and control. We do have some questions from the audience to start with. I think some of the topics you've already touched upon, but still I have listed down the questions asked by audience. So I'll start with a question from Dr. Virendra Jain. It says, are probiotics must with every antibiotic in practice?
Yes, actually, you see, the risk, what they have said is more with cephalosporin and amlodipine. These are antibiotics are used more commonly, and they are going to lead to disturbed microbial flora. So we are having an evidence of association with use of antibiotic even for a single cause, as I told you in that study from Mayo Clinic. The more number of prescriptions you're using for common antibiotic, like for example amoxicillin or amoxicillin microlides, again the effects get cumulative. So till we get a strong evidence, you must use probiotic with almost all antibiotic prescription. This is the basic inference which you get from this study from Mayo Clinic, because it has told very clearly in all the results they were significant statistically. So I think if you see the study, all antibiotic prescription, they must be accompanied by probiotics for during antibiotic therapy, and also giving at least 1 to 2 weeks after we stop the antibiotic.
Sure, sir. The next question is, how to control antibiotic induced diarrhea even before it happens?
So the only way, as you see, as Bulardi has got an excellent role in preventing AAD, because if you see almost 6-7 world bodies, right from ESPGHAN and World Gastroenterology Organization, they have recommended, even National has indicated that Esbladi has got a very important role in preventing AAD. So whenever you are using any antibiotic, particularly cephalosporin or macrolides or imipenem, meropenem and all, you must add probiotics, particularly Esbladi or LGG, give it for duration of the therapy and at least for 1 to 2 weeks after it stops. So if you are using this probiotic along with antibiotic therapy, I think you will not get AAD.
Sure, sir. The next question is, are the long-term consequences of dysbiosis, are they related clinically, is the question.
Yes, like if you have gone through this Mayo Clinic study, they had a very excellent follow-up. Children who were given antibiotic in the first 2 years of life, they were followed for a period of at least 11 years till they got about 17 years old. And they associated very clearly that those children who had received antibiotic, they became high incidence of asthma, high incidence of allergy, obesity, inflammatory bowel disease. So I think, and as I told you, there were a huge number of papers indicating that even practice of Mayo Clinic study, right from 2010, we have had a number of papers indicating that if you are using antibiotic either prenatally or in the first year of life, there is a higher chances of this disease. So although last word is still not out, we don't have any last word indicating that yes, giving antibiotic, this particular antibiotic for this particular period will lead to asthma 100%. But since the amount of paper which are coming more and more, I think in coming couple of years, this association would be firmed up and you will have a very final answer. I think till that time, I think the evidence is now mounting up, piling up, that please use your antibiotic in rational manner. Ensure that microbiota in the first 6 months of life, it is safe and secure, and give breastfeeding for at least 6 months so that it ensures a healthy microbiota, because clinical evidence is now mounting up. You are getting more and more papers which are indicating that yes, there is correlation, but again I'll say final word is still not out.
Sure, sir.
Yes.
The next question is, I think, slightly away from the dysbiosis, but the question is, does pre or probiotics have a role in viral diarrhea? Is there any Indian evidence?
Yes. There are few datas regarding the use of probiotic in rotaviral diarrhea. There are some state reports in India. But across the world, again, for rotaviral diarrhea, again, if you have guidelines from ESPGHAN, and from World Gastroenterology Organization, they have very clearly indicated that use of probiotic, particularly S-Boulard and LGG, they can decrease the duration of diarrhea by at least one day. And there is very clear evidence. So if you go through ESPECAN guidelines 20220, World Gastroenterology guidelines 2017, they have indicated that S-Boulard and LGG are indicated to treat viral diarrhea, particularly viral diarrhea, and they can decrease duration by at least one day. And again, I have to add, Bacillus clausi, it doesn't have any effect. They have clearly indicated that Bacillus clausi is not a drug of choice. So we use this clausi left and right. But if you see the guidelines across the world, they none guidelines they indicate clausi. So we are having very firm evidence across from other part of the world, not from India, that yes, probiotic, prebiotic, they got a very important role in treating viral diarrhea.
Okay, sir. The next question is, does use of probiotics in neonates with sepsis, who are on broad spectrum antibiotics, does it help in salvaging the gut microbiome?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Very important, because if you have a premature baby, now there are guidelines from NNF and from the world body, even from Cochrane review, that if you give probiotic in these preemies, it is going to prevent NAC. And in fact, it is one of the standard of care now that all these very low birth weight babies, when they are born, they are given probiotic right from day one. So giving probiotic is going to make a normal microflora and it's going to prevent NAC. So yes, whenever you get a child who is septic, whenever you get an infection, it is going to make your microflora absolutely go haywire. So adding probiotic in sepsis, although there are no standard guidelines which indicate that you must supplement probiotic along with antibiotic in sepsis, but if you see all these papers, they all indicate that if you're using an antibiotic in first 6 months, definitely your microflora is going to go haywire, and effect is going to last for months to years. So yes, whenever you are treating any child with antibiotic, newborn, if he is in a stable condition so that you can give oral drugs, definitely you must add antibiotic. Of course, if he is on vasopressor, in shock, or something like NAC or perforated gut, probably you may not do. But whenever a child with sepsis, whenever a child stabilizes, you can start with oral feeding. Definitely you must add probiotic. There is no doubt about it.
Got it, sir. I think we have one more last question, Dr. Mahesh Sharma. So he's saying there are other strains available as well currently. What is the advantage of only CNCM I745?
Actually, this is a strain, CNCM I745. This is a strain which has been used. This is the original strain of S-Boulard and this has been used in all the trials. Wherever the trials have been done, wherever this drug has been found to be effective, this particular strain has been used. So in all the guidelines, you may see from ESPECAN or World Gastroenterology Organization or from Cochrane review, all the trials which have been done, they've been done using this particular strain. Whereas if you are taking other strain which doesn't contain from this particular genie, you don't know what is the effect. So I think since we have got evidence with this particular strain, we should not use generic molecule. We should use this particular strain only because we have got a strong evidence of its action. Plus all the guidelines, they also see about this particular strain. So again, my advice, whenever you're using S-Boulard, please check the wrapper. Please check with the representative whether you are using this particular strain. If not, I think it will be risky. Don't use generic molecules, please.
Sure, sir. I think I have one other question. You mentioned in dysbiosis, there is a long-term consequence. Considering other factors, do you recommend any certain indications where you would add a probiotic to the antibiotic treatment? Maybe everyone, you see a risk group, one group having a more prediction to have dysbiosis compared to others, so you will advise in that particular group?
So So till now, we have not found out anything like if you see the Mayo study, all the children who were included in that study, it contained about 40,000 children. And they were all normal children. They had excluded children who had any disease or any genetic problem. They were excluded. So they were 14,000 normal children who were followed for at least 15 years. So there is no risk group which is in which you have to give probiotic and other will not. So I think it is a standard advice that whenever you're using an antibiotic, please use it judiciously. In case if you feel that it is important to use, I think use probiotic along with the antibiotic for the duration of antibiotic therapy and at least for 2 weeks beyond that. And for treatment, we have got evidence for antibiotic associated diarrhea. For us, diseases like, for example, asthma, allergies, although the role of probiotics are now coming up very fast, but still we don't have very firm guidelines indicating that these probiotics can be used to treat this problem. They can be used to prevent this problem, but to treat, we still will have to wait for some more time to have more evidence, more guidelines to come. But till now, entire spectrum of dysbiosis, we have got very firm evidence for treatment of diarrhea. But for others, probably will have to wait for some more guidelines. But as you see the amount of evidence which is piling up, I am sure in the next about 3 to 4 years, you will have very firm evidence and very firm guidelines indicating that, yes, this antibiotic, given this disease is going to occur, use those probiotic both to prevent as well as to treat. I think that day is not far in which probably we'll have very firm guideline. Till now, the only guideline wherever you have evidence is in antibiotic associated diarrhea, first infantile colic, second and third in NEC. So these three conditions we have got very firm guideline. Rest all probably we'll have to wait for some more evidence.
Sure, sir. I think that was the last of the questions I had in this webinar. So on behalf of Dr. Reddy's, I'd like to thank you for taking our time to come over and give a very clear and practical deliberation on antibiotic associated dysbiosis and how it has been showing some consequences lately, and then there is a way to manage this dysbiosis. I'd like to thank you on behalf of Dr. Reddy's, and also I'd like to thank the attendees who have come here today. Thank you so much for joining in today, and
thanks to all.
Any closing comments? Yes.
Okay. Thanks to all. And I again, thank Dr. Reddy for organizing this important seminar. I'll thank Dr. Krishna for staying with me. And I hope that this talk will be useful to all the people who attended this seminar. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Stay safe. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Goodbye, everyone.